بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وأسرتنا وقائدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما وعملا يا رب العالمين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. وبعد، respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. It's an honor and a privilege for me to be in your midst today. I would like to thank the two organizers of today's event, Bayt al-Hamd and Masjid al-Baqi, for arranging this program, a very important topic. And I would like to thank all of you as well for coming after a very long, hard week. Friday night is like the end of the week here as well, yes, just like UK. So Friday night, everybody wants to just relax at home. But alhamdulillah, mashallah, you have all come here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of you, brothers and sisters. May He grant us the ability. My voice is low. May He grant us the ability to say that which is beneficial for all of us, inshallah. I won't take too much of your time because I know it's the end of the week. You may be tired. And I am also kind of tired. I came last night, but still I'm still jet lagged slightly, and the sleep pattern and the hours and everything just messed up at the moment. So I was thinking how to approach this topic. We have the poster here, Mirage of Atheism. I could have made this, and which I could on another occasion, a very sophisticated, intellectual and academic type of discussion, where we look at theories and evolution and all of this with all the depth and detail. But given it's Friday night and it's 9:30 p.m. and like I said, it's the end of the week, and plus I'm also mentally not in a state to talk about everything in that detail. Therefore, I want to approach this topic in a slightly different way, in a different manner, which is more easy to absorb and a bit lighter, relatively. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has made us believers, Muslims, in the Ummah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some of us, most of us are born Muslims, some of us may have embraced Islam. This issue, the phenomena of what we call apostasy, the issue of people leaving Islam, and when they do leave Islam, they become atheists. Very rarely you have situations where Muslims leave Islam and they become Christians or Jews. That's very rare, unless you have a girlfriend or a boyfriend and you want to get with them or something like that. May Allah protect and preserve everybody. But generally, it's atheism. So these two things come together: apostasy and atheism. In Arabic, atheism is known as ilhad. The Arabs have been discussing this for quite a long time. Many of ulama in the Arab world, they are writing books. This is something that they've been debating and discussing, and it's not new. Atheism is not something that's new. Historically, there were atheists, and everything's evolved in the world, and the people who talk about evolution, they've not evolved. Everything's evolved. The atheists, they have the same arguments that they used to have 600 years, 1,000 years. It's just different wording. And most of their intellectual, academic type of points that they raised, they've all been discussed, refuted by not just Muslims, by even non-Muslim intellectuals. So apostasy and atheism, these two things come together. Many times we think that this is a problem, and it is a problem. A lot of people become very dull and very gloomy and very sad, and we should be sad. Even one person leaving Islam, it's a responsibility of every Muslim. Not just parents. Parents are worried. I know here in the United States and in North America in general, whatever happens here happens back in England, where I come from. Even there, we had recently an event about 2-3 months ago that there's this, I won't call it the epidemic. They called it, the title was the epidemic of apostasy, that there are people leaving Islam. But seriously, if you look at it, in relation to those people who are leaving Islam, the amount of people who are coming into Islam is far greater. Just in England, in the United Kingdom, a few months ago, there was a government report. I have it here with me. This was the government. They have this report that they take out every year. And this was their report on ethnic minorities, on just generally different aspects. And they said, this is from the report, this which was released 2 months ago. Amongst faith groups, the number of people identifying themselves as Muslims grew most significantly by 1.2 million people. Most. The people who say we are Muslims, in the last year, from all the different faiths, Muslims grew the most. 72% increase. The Muslims increased by 72%. This is higher than for any other religious group in the United Kingdom. And Muslims make up the largest non-Christian religious population. When we say non-Christian, many Christians are by name Christians, really. So Muslims might be the largest faith followers in England. After Christianity in England, Muslims make up the highest religious population, but at 2.8 million. How many Muslims in England? And we have about how many million there? About 55, 60, 60 million. 2.8 million Muslims in total, compared with 0.8 million Hindus, 0.4 million Sikhs, 0.3 million Jews, and 0.3 million Buddhists. So, many people are accepting Islam. We are, of course, worried and concerned that there are people who are becoming atheists, they are leaving Islam. But on the other hand, many people are coming into the fold of Islam, not just in Europe, not just in the United Kingdom, but even here. After 9/11, how many people have come into Islam? Never before that many people have come into the fold of Islam as they have after 9/11. And this makes me think of, or reminds me of, the verse of the Quran. Allah says in the Quran, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ. If you turn away from Allah, if you don't want to practice deen, then Allah will change and bring another group who will embrace Islam, and they will practice Islam, and they will take your place. What we have to worry is that if we're leaving, or our family leaving, there's always going to be people. This is a guarantee. Allah said, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Allah will preserve this deen. He will protect the Quran. He will protect the Sunnah. This whole deen will be preserved until Yawmul Qiyamah. Muslims will be, the final hour will come when there's nobody there to say Allah. That's in the hadith of an authentic hadith. So Muslims will always remain. They'll actually increase. But the question is that, are we going to remain Muslims? The question is, are our children going to remain Muslims? That's the question. And it is the parents' responsibility. It's everyone's responsibility. It's not just the imam's responsibility, or the teachers, or the scholars, or the sheikhs, or the people in other positions of authority. It's every single Muslim, male, female. It's our responsibility that we make sure we remain steadfast on our deen, and we ensure that our children remain steadfast. This is one of the greatest challenges in the West. One of the greatest challenges of Muslims in the West is the preservation of the iman of our progeny. It's a big issue. I was born in the West myself. I was born in England. I wasn't born anywhere else. All my life I've lived in England. It's very important. We have the third, fourth generation in England. This is one of the greatest responsibilities. We've come to these countries. We were born in these countries. Our parents came to these countries maybe. Or our grandparents came. We came for economic reasons mostly. No problem. Even though some people gave fatwa at that time and some people still give fatwa to today, it's haram for you to go to live there. In the Arab world, I met a sheikh in Egypt once. He said, I still have the clear fatwa. It's not allowed for Muslims to go and live there. I'm not saying I agree with that. I'm just saying this is what he said. And lots of people give this type of ruling. But okay, no problem. We came, but whoever allows, and any of the ulama and fuqaha from the different various schools, when they did allow Muslims to live in non-Muslim lands, the main condition was, the greatest condition was, that only if you can ensure that you and your children will remain on Iman, because you will be affected. One of the great scholars of the subcontinent, Sheikh Abu al-Hasan Ali al-Nadwi rahimahullah, in the 70s or the 60s, he gave a very powerful lecture which is recorded in books. And he said to the Muslims, he came to England and gave a lecture, I think in the 60s, that I fear for your future generation living in these lands, unless you ensure that you have deen and iman and Islam at home. And this doesn't mean that we don't tackle these issues straight on, every issue. And I'm going to talk about some issues that young people get affected by. This is just an introduction really. We have to tackle them. We have to answer the questions. And some of the things that sometimes we contribute our own selves, we contribute towards some of them having doubt or leaving Islam or leaving deen. So, I was saying that yes, a lot of people are coming into the fold of Islam. It's not something that it's an epidemic that everyone's leaving Islam. A lot of people are coming into Islam. And when they do come into Islam, one of the reasons why do they come into Islam? Because they see the beauty of this religion. This is why, if you look historically, the Muslim, the ulama in their books, they never actually discussed. They never discussed atheism. They never discussed, they didn't even discuss about proving God. Because that was a foregone conclusion. And historically, nobody was an atheist. Historically, we didn't have atheists like we have today. Nowadays, atheists have become like militant style. Reason being is that the surroundings are supporting them. The whole secular system is supporting this. Even in the olden times, if somebody was an atheist, they used to be closet atheists. They used to hide. It was something abnormal. If somebody denies God, I'm talking about whether if you're not Christian or Jew or any type of God, any faith, if you denied God, you would be someone who would be imbalanced or mental health issues in your mind in the early times, 300-400 years ago. There was no place for atheists in the olden times. Reason being, because it is absolutely natural. The fitrah, this is what the hadith says, كُلُّ مَوْلُودٍ يُولَدُ عَلَى الْفِطْرَةِ. Every human being is born on fitrah. The natural fitrah, the sound disposition of every human being is that naturally they believe in God. You know, even an atheist, I've met atheists. You know, there was one atheist, I tried this on him. You know, I just pinched him from here. Oh my God, where did your God come from now? It's the natural heart that spoke. You talk to an atheist. Some, you know, they deny God, but something goes wrong. Oh God, God just comes out. It's the natural. They might not believe in the God of the Muslims. I don't believe in it, but they do believe in something. And this is God. If they actually, some of them say that no, this whole universe created itself. You know, something has to create. Now, if this whole universe created themselves, you either believe in some powerful, you either believe in this jahil, ignorant, inanimate object creating itself, or you believe in a powerful alim al-qadir, the powerful being creating something. So many of them, I will come to that, but I was saying that historically, it was an imbalanced disposition. It was not a natural disposition of a human being, the fitrah. This is why the Quran doesn't even talk about proving Allah's existence. The Quran says, أَفِلَّهِ شَكٌ فَاطِرِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. About Allah, is there a doubt who created the heavens and the earth? How can you even doubt that? All the prophets from Adam alayhi salatu wasalam till the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasalam, nobody called their people towards believing in God. They called towards Tawheed. Every prophet called towards Tawheed. Believe in one and only God. وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. If you ask the mushrikeen of Mecca, who created the heavens and the earth? لَيَقُولَنَّ اللَّهِ. They say God. Allah, God. They all believed, all the mushrikun of Mecca, they believed in God. But they used to commit a shirk, associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why the Quran never talks about the wujud, the existence of Allah. Allah doesn't talk about that. Allah talks about tawheed. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum. Fa'lam annahu la ilaha illa Allah. Wa ilahukum ilahu wahid. La ilaha illa huwa ar-rahman ar-rahim. All the ayat, all the verses of the Quran, pick the Quran up, you see all the verses talk about tawheed. There's nowhere the existence of God. And the early scholars didn't even discuss, because there was no need, there was nobody who denied it. It was as illogical to deny that this world exists. And that's what some of the atheists are saying now. Because, you know, one thing, they get complicated. Because one thing brings up another thing, but then if they say this, then this. There are atheists right now, they deny that this universe exists. Because if they say that this universe exists, they have to ultimately forced to say that there's actually a Khaliq that has created it. So some of them, they actually deny the existence of, they deny design. They deny that there's a design in place, the way Allah has placed the design in everything. Just imagine this sun that Allah has created, day in, day out, such in a meticulous way, in such a meticulous manner, the way the whole cosmos system works. You have to believe in a God. So some of these atheists, they actually deny the existence. You might say, how can they deny it? But even though they're illogical, yet they are more intellectual than the one who says there is a universe but there's no creator. That's even more illogical. Because they have two types of atheists. So this was absolutely abnormal. I was saying, even the scholars earlier on, they never discussed the wujud of Allah. You know, many of them, they discussed? They discussed the proofs of the prophecy of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam al-Bayhaqi is a great scholar. He wrote a book, Dala'il al-Nubuwa. All the proofs of the Nubuwa of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's what we need to prove. Because in other words, if you're saying that, you're actually, because if he's a prophet, then he's been sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what they discussed. The early books of Aqidah, there's a book, Aqidah Tahawiyah, that many of the scholars, they study. There's no mention of Aqidah, who I believe in the existence of Allah. It was in the latter times when these atheists became militant because of the surroundings that gave them that ammunition. So therefore, later on people started discussing this. The scholars just discussed the prophecy of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And many people who embrace Islam, they actually, this is a side point, but they actually become Muslims because when they see, I met once, there was this in Detroit, in America, here in Detroit, many, many years ago, six, seven years ago. I met a brother, he became Muslim. I asked him, I said, how did you become Muslim? He said, the reason I became Muslim was, I said, did you study the Quran? He said, no, I never studied the Quran. Somebody once gave me a small booklet with the brief biography or like the characteristics or attributes of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when I read this, I was just in awe, absolute amazing human being. Then I asked him, I said, do you have some more books? So he gave me some more books and I started reading about this great man, his characteristics, the way he lived, the way he was as a man, as a husband, as a family man, as a leader, as a person, how he dealt with people. He said, I became immersed in this biography, especially his akhlaq and his character. And like the Quran said, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ, that we have put you on a very high pedestal of akhlaq. When I read this, I fell in love with this man. And I said to myself, there's nobody can be like this, unless he is a supernatural being. Like, he is a human, but he's not like other human beings. It's only from Allah, and it's true, many other non-Muslims who became Muslims said the same thing, that seeing the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how he is, you know, we talk about seerah, we try to act upon sunnah, we can never be like the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that's impossible, we say emulate him, like 5% of him is good enough. To be like him, you have to be a prophet. It's an amazing level of character. Just read his seerah, we don't read his seerah. Simple example, Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu says, خَدِمْتُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَمْ عَشْرَ سِنِينَ. I served the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 10 years. فَمَا قَالَ لِي أُفٍّ قَطُّ 10 years you've got a person you've employed, your servant. This servant of yours, he brings tea for you and coffee for you and food for you and he works for you day and night. You're in control, you pay him. You pay him wages and salary. 10 years, he never said the word uff to me in 10 years. Like uff means like a sigh. And then he said, he never said to me ever for a thing that I did, why did you do it? Or for something I shouldn't have done, why did you do it? 10 years, imagine, can you imagine a person in 10 years? This is just one example, there are numerous examples. Just the seerah has examples filled. There was one new Muslim, a revered brother, he said, it's impossible for any man to be like this in terms of his character, his akhlaq, not to be a prophet. It's just impossible, it's illogical. Only a prophet can be like this. And then he said there's so many other things. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam predicted so many things which came into existence. And his prophecy was also in the previous prophets, scriptures as well. So this whole atheism is a recent phenomenon in a militant way, in a very forceful way. Maybe before it was, but it wasn't in that way. Because nowadays, the problem, brothers and sisters, is that nowadays everything unnatural, abnormal, imbalanced has been made mainstream. This is the problem. In every sphere of life, people's minds and brains, okay, we're very careful what we say, okay? Muslims, we're not supposed to hate on anybody, and this is not what Islam teaches, right? So we have to be very careful, and we're very clear about that. But we have a viewpoint, like anyone can have any viewpoint. Christians have a viewpoint, Jews have a viewpoint, as long as you don't force it down anybody, and as long as you're not aggressive with that, and you're not committing any crimes. But people have viewpoints. Yeah? Some of you support New York Yankees, you'll be militantly supporting New York Yankees. Is that baseball or basketball or ice hockey? I don't know what it is. Baseball. I don't know your sports here. The only sports we know in England is what you call soccer. Yeah, that's the only proper sport in the world, there's nothing else. But anyway, there was once, there was BBC, they were doing some documentaries. They came to interview me as well. So they were talking about why are Muslims or why any religion, why are you so forceful on your religion? Like, why do you say this is the only true religion? Is this not extremism? I said to them, you know what, the people of the same thing, like we have a viewpoint where the only reason I'm a Muslim and we are Muslims because we think this is the truth. Otherwise, why would I be a Muslim? If I thought everything's fine, you can have a choice then. Today Muslim, tomorrow Christian, then today Jew, then back to Muslim, morning, breakfast Muslim, lunch Jew, dinner Christian, it's all, why do I have to put the effort? The only reason why I'm a Muslim is because I, inna deena inda Allah in Islam. This is the only true religion. And I have a right to believe in that. That doesn't mean I hate the Christians. That doesn't mean I hate the Jews. That doesn't mean I can coexist with them. That doesn't mean I don't be hospitable towards them. I am kind, considerate, hospitable. They can come and eat at my house. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ate at a Jewish man's house and he invited a Jewish person to his house. Has any Muslims ever invited a Jewish person to his house to eat? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam invited a Jewish man for food at his house and he went and he accepted an invitation in Medina. Some Muslims like, they're thinking, you have so many Jews here, invite some, no problem. There's nothing wrong with that. It's not haram to shake. I came to the airport here and there was a Jewish person next to me and I shook his hands and everything. I was hospitable. This is what the Quran teaches us. But that doesn't mean that I think his religion is right. No. In the same way he thinks that Islam is not correct. That's why he's a Jew. Why would he be a Jew? So I told this BBC reporter, I said, the reason everyone believes their religion, we have a right to believe. And what we do, the sports fans do it even more aggressively, but you have no problem. We don't swear, or we shouldn't be swearing. We think Islam is the true religion. We don't swear. We're not, phobia. We don't have a phobia towards other religions. But if you look at sports, New York Yankee fans, they'll be hurling abuse at the other, even during the match, they're fighting and, swearing and everything. Where's your extremism gone there? Why don't you have laws for that? No laws. And they also said, why do you teach your children when they grow up that you have to be a Muslim? all these sports fans, they brainwash their children to follow their father's sports team. We have Liverpool and Manchester United. Yes? There's one guy who was traveling with me, and he said, my son, I don't know, he's going to support Manchester United, but no, this is not right. You know, if it's my child, he has to be a Liverpool fan. Like, I'm going to make sure this is not right. This is going off the truth. Parents, they actually, from a young age, they drill it into their heads. You grow. They say if you grow in a house, you grow up and you're raised in a house where your parents are supporting the team, then that's it. You have to follow that team. These guys do it more militantly than religious people who follow religions, but there's no laws, there's no extremism, there's nothing, no problem, you can do whatever you want. So anyway, I was saying, yes, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his characteristics. Many people, that person I met, and he said that he became Muslim because of reading the characteristics of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There was something else, I didn't finish off. But anyway, the next point, that alhamdulillah, we are all Muslims and Allah has given us Islam. But many people have doubts. Not many people, some people, doubts come into the mind and the hearts. And that's absolutely natural and normal. Doubts coming in. Doubts like what? Sometimes doubts regarding certain teachings of the religion. We can go into that, and I'll give some examples of that, time allows. But more important than that, the more dangerous type of doubts are when people start having doubts in their mind about the actual belief in Deen and Islam. Okay? I'll come to that. The point I was trying to, I remembered now, that the atheists are very, very militant in this day and age because everything is imbalanced. That's what I was talking about. It's very imbalanced. The fitrah, the natural fitrah of the human being was to believe in a God, believe in a powerful God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But everything's become imbalanced. Right now, in England, it's like this, and I'm sure it's here. This is what I was saying, that we don't hate anything, anyone, any religion. This is what I was saying. That what I'm saying is not to hate on anybody. But this imbalance is in every aspect of life. So now, the classic example of an atheist. Okay? I've spoken to some in England. The classic example of an atheist in England, and maybe here as well. You've got a female. She is... number one, all these things together. She's number one, she's a lesbian. Number two, she's non-binary. Nowadays, people are, you know, I was reading the newspaper on my way here, in the flight, that they want laws to be passed where in your passport, you shouldn't be forced to say you're a male or a female. And it'll be soon, give it another 4 or 5 years, nowadays you have an option, male, female, or they said X, something else. They're really fighting for this, that they want. There are people who don't believe that you have to be a gender. You call them somewhat transgenders or trans, we have children as well, I don't want to get too much specifics, but non-binary, gender fluid. All of these things come together. You see, when the fitrah of the mind, when you get imbalanced, then you become imbalanced totally in everything. So, the sexuality is imbalanced according to our understanding of religion. That doesn't mean we're homophobic. We don't hate anybody. I'm just clarifying that. If anyone's recording, we clarify this. But you have people who have what we would consider to be impermissible sexuality, which is not allowed in Islam. And then at the same time, gender fluid, male, female. Then also, there's different words now. All these terms have come up. I've researched many of them. You have something called pansexual. There are people who say we're not, you know, people, like, normally the attraction is towards a member of the opposite gender. And then we came into homosexuality, attraction towards the same gender, male, female, female. Now there are people saying that this in itself is wrong. There's no gender. I don't feel attracted to any particular gender, gender fluidity. Pansexual means I'm attracted to a soul. It's like, it's not a man or a woman. It's just anything that has a soul. Could be a tree, Allahu Akbar. So, this is the sexuality, lesbian. Number two, gender fluid, non-binary. And then, pansexual. Then, atheist. It comes hand in hand. The same person is an atheist. maybe lefty, maybe liberal, and also, sorry, sisters are listening, a hardcore feminist. All of this comes together hand in hand. When I say hardcore feminist, because the word feminist has many connotations. There's some right type of, if you say just standing up for your right and not being oppressed, Islam agrees with that. But some of the feminism is extremism. And that's why we have now meminists. Have you heard of meminists? The people, men standing up for their rights, because this feminism is like, it's for many, many years, women were oppressed. Now, the foot is on the other side. You know, alhamdulillah, you guys are being oppressed. Inshallah not. I was in, again, Detroit. There was an Egyptian imam there. I gave a whole talk on the rights of the husband. This was about 2011 or something. And he said to me after that, in our community, the most oppression, abuse is actually from women towards men. That's what he told me. And I've mentioned this in many, many talks after that. Especially, I always remember, I said, when I went to America in 2010, this is what they told me in Detroit. There was a masjid there, there was an Egyptian imam, and he told me about this. And then I experienced this myself in Toronto once. It was one of these conferences, that famous conference they have. I had a talk, and some brothers came to me after that and told me about this. So all of this, feminism, atheism, all these things, because gender roles are mixed up. Most atheists will be, their gender roles are mixed. They don't believe in gender roles. If you study this, there's a pattern's falling, where there's imbalance going against the natural fitrah that Allah has created. This is why what we need to first do is bring back fitrah, cleanliness in the heart, sound-mindedness. A lot of them are not even willing to listen. If someone is really, truly confused and if wants to and is willing to listen, most of them are skeptical, like, oh, this guy's going to talk about God or this. You already closed 90% of your window, your curtain. They're skeptical, they don't want to listen. If somebody really is genuinely sincere, then honestly, I guarantee that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open the doors. But what Allah wants from us is a clean, open heart. I'll mention an incident, a story. This happened many years ago, but this was related by one of my teachers. He's mentioned this somewhere. I heard it from him in a talk, and it's also in the books. It's written. He mentioned, he mentions this, that there was a brother who used to live in Germany. This is about 20, 25 years ago. He used to live in Germany. He married a Christian woman for many, many years. One day, what happened was that he had children. He was Muslim, married a Christian. He had children, and he saw his wife that she was taking them to the church and raising them up as Christians. So he suddenly it hit him, like, my children, Christians, and he was, you know, a born Muslim. Of course, he had an iman, even though he wasn't practicing. In his words, he said, I'm not practicing. But it hit him. So he wrote to the Sheikh, and he said, you know, I don't know what to do. Can you give me some advice? So the Sheikh wrote back to him. I'll cut the story short. He wrote back to him, and he said, look, what you do is sit down with your wife, and both of you do this. Tell her that, look, me and you, both of you, us, every night we will sit separately in separate rooms and we'll beseech God. You believe in God, I believe in God. Because this was about Christianity and Islam. It's just an example of turning to Allah. So you believe in God, I believe in God. Every night you go and beseech Allah and speak to God and cry and beg for half an hour. Say, oh God, if Christianity is the truth, keep me steadfast and make me even more stronger. Make my children powerful, good Christians. And if it's not the truth, take my heart away from it and make me a Muslim. And I will do the same in my room. I will cry as well. And I will talk to Allah, I'll speak to God with sincerity. Let's not have any bias towards any religion. Let's do both of us, do this. And then he also said, I'm sending you a book. He had a book that he wrote, which is called What is Christianity? It's in Arabic as well, Mahiyya Nasraniya. He said, give this to your wife and tell her to read this as well whenever she can. Anyway, he sent the letter. After about 2 weeks, that brother from Germany, he wrote back to him. And in the letter reply, he said, we've been doing this for a couple of weeks, but there's nothing. She looks like she's an even more powerful Christian. You know, nothing's changed. She doesn't want anything to do with Islam or the children, to do anything with, just change the names of the children as well. So the Sheikh said, don't worry, no problem. Carry on doing it, do it for at least 40 days. Carry on, continues for 40 days. Why 40? Random number. There's no like, you don't need an I in the Quran, oh you people, you know, 40 is available, everything you need. It's just like, 40 is good, you know, it's just, he could have said 42. Okay, 42 then, no problem. So, he said, continues doing it for like around 40 days. When he sent that letter, no reply came for a few weeks, 6-7 weeks, 40 days had passed. And then after a few weeks after that, he wrote back. And in the letter, he said, As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, I am so amazed. People believe in God, like through listening, you know, taqleed and like just following. I have witnessed Allah from my heart and from my mind. I've seen the miracles in my life. And he said, well, we've been doing this. Straight after about 40 days, 1 or 2 days after that, we were both in the car going. She was driving and I was sitting in the passenger seat. She was studying at the university in Germany, Berlin or whatever. And, you know, we were going to the university because she had some examination or something. And suddenly while she was driving, she swerved the car and nearly had an accident. Took it to the side and she, you know, put her foot on the brake and she stopped the car. And she put her head on the steering wheel and she was shedding tears and crying. And she was like, something extremely wrong with her. So I got so scared. I said, is everything okay? You know, shall I call the ambulance? I took my phone and I was just about to call the ambulance. That is, what's happened? Have you become unconscious or something? She said, no, don't. You don't need to call the ambulance. Put the phone down. Just before you do, don't call the ambulance. Just take me to the closest masjid. I want to become a Muslim. And then she told him that, I've been doing this. Last 2 days, there's just this feeling in my heart. Like suddenly, I don't know what's happened. It's just, I've got this amazing feeling that I just want to be a Muslim. And I've, you know, Allah's opened the heart and the mind. This is an example of somebody who is not biased. Someone who truly wants to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dua, turning to Allah, is extremely powerful, brothers and sisters. Seriously, it can do miracles. That's why the hadith says, a dua usilahul mu'min. We need to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyone who has doubts. Now doubts, I will talk just briefly about doubts. People have doubts, and doubts are normal. Actually, they've always had, even the Sahaba had doubts. What kind of doubts? Doubts like sometimes, you know, like, is there really a God? Is it something, you know, like, is there really a hereafter? Even though, because you see, we human beings, we are very sense-based. There are certain things, because it's difficult for us human beings, because we are very limited, for us to comprehend things which are beyond our five senses. Things we can taste, easy to comprehend. Things we can smell, easy to comprehend. Taste, smell, touch, hear, see. Anything which goes beyond our five senses, we find it very difficult. But still we believe in a lot of the things. Some things we don't see. Electricity we don't see. Sadness we don't see. We don't see actual sadness. We don't see actual happiness. We don't see actual hunger. Where is hunger? What color is hunger, brother? Green or blue or yellow or red or pink? What color is hunger? There's no color to it. Where is it? Like, the effect of it is there. The athar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ghayr mahsus. He is beyond the five his. He is beyond having, beyond the five senses. But we don't deny everything that is beyond our five senses. There are so many signs to Allah. Just like hunger is a sign. Likewise, thirst is a sign. This is why some of the scholars said, لِلَّهِ تَرَائِقْ بِقَدْرِ أَنْفَاسِ الْخَلَائِقِ. There are the way to Allah, or recognizing God, there are as many ways as there are, the number is equal to the number of the breaths taken by all of humanity and the whole of creation. Everything, that's why some of them said, وَفِي كُلِّ شَيْءٍ لَهُ آيَةٌ تَدُلُّ عَلَىٰ أَنَّهُ وَاحِدٌ. Everything takes you to God, shows you that there's only one God. Everything, the Quran tells us about this. And this is why we don't do this, this is what we need to do. The Quran says, look at everything around us, all of you here, every single one of us here, we are a sign of the existence of God. But this is only if the mind is not imbalanced, if the mind is not, you know, deviated, there's no perversion. We have perversions now, zayl, which is perversion. You know, when everything is now twisted. Because we are twisted in our brain, that's why we don't see everything for a person with clean heart and mind. That's why those people who embrace Islam, they have a clean heart, and then Allah gives them the iman because they have that clean heart. They see the truth because of the cleanliness of the heart. When the heart is polluted, when the mind is polluted with all the imbalanced things around us, then it's very difficult to find the truth. Everything, there's a sign. That's why the Quran says, وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصَرُونَ. In your own selves, don't you look? The human body, do you know the human body in itself? I was speaking to a medical expert specialist recently. He told me that even though medical science has advanced, and some of you may be doctors here, has advanced so much, the eye specialists, they've only discovered 10% of the eye. There's so much to discover. The human body, so many medics became Muslims, they recognized God through medicine. There's so much in medicine. That's why the Quran says, وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. This, the human body, there's so much. One cell can have any human being. You know, we talk about right now cloning and this and that and different things. Nothing is created from nothingness. Anything that anyone creates has to create from something that already existed. Cloning doesn't mean you just clone somebody. It's cloning, taking a human cell from one part of the body, and you have to have something. Nothing can be created from nothingness. So the Quran says, look at your body, look at everything around you, the heavens, the skies, everything, even astronomy. Just imagine the whole of astronomy, the cosmos system, the galaxies, it's just absolutely mind-boggling. But it just passes by us. It just passes by us. Everything points towards the Creator. And this is why the Quran tells us to contemplate. You know what this contemplate is mentioned in the Quran? It's called tafakkur. Have you heard of the word dhikr, fikr? Fikr, some people misunderstand, especially those who speak Urdu, they misunderstand the word fikr. The word fikr in the subcontinent language means something else, and it means something else in Arabic. In Urdu or subcontinent languages, the word fikr means worry. In Arabic, fikr doesn't mean worry. It's from the word tafakkur. Sometimes it's a similar word in Arabic and Urdu, but it's a complete different meaning in Arabic and a complete different meaning in Urdu. That's why sometimes people make a mistake when they just speak Urdu and they don't even know the Arabic term. Fikr in Arabic means tafakkur. الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقْعُودًا عَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Pondering, reflecting over everything and anything around you. This is actually, and this is one of the solutions or one of the practical lessons I want us to take with us here. Make it a daily habit with your families, with your children, to do tafakkur. Dhikr doesn't only mean, you know, we hear, this is also a solution to mental health issues. Many of these people, you know, when I gave a list of all these things, I had one more thing: mental health. Seriously, I'm not saying this, I'm not calling them mental, they themselves are saying it. I've spoken to a lot of people. They actually, because it's not a taboo anymore, mental, and it shouldn't be a taboo. Mental health is not a problem. It's even Muslims have it. You can be a person of religion. I gave a whole lecture last year in Ireland, about 2 hours, on mental health and Islam and solutions. So it's not. But many of them have seen the pattern. Those people who have these list of things that gave, non-binary, gender fluidity, etc., etc., many of them actually say that I suffer from mental health and depression. Many of them have said that. So, what was I saying? Tafakkur, yes. This is also a solution for happiness. Because a lot of people are sad in this world. People have money, wealth, prosperity. Internal peace is not found in many people. How many prosperous people, sports stars, people going to depression, drug abuse, etc. Real means, the real internal happiness is not found in the heart, in the life. This is one of the solutions, tafakkur. Tafakkur, what does tafakkur mean? Do it as a family. It's actually ibadah. You know, going out and looking at, you know, going out, looking at the stars, traveling. The Quran says, يَسِيرُ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَيَنْظُرُوا. Go travel and look at the earth. قُلْ أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبِلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ وَإِلَى السَّمَاءِ كَيْفَ رُفِعَتْ وَإِلَى الْجِبَالِ كَيْفَ نُصِبَتْ وَإِلَى الْأَرْضِ كَيْفَ سُطِحَتْ. Look at everything around you. This is part of ibadah. Dhikr is dhikr lisani, which is to say Allah or pray Salah or recite Quran with the tongue. And then dhikr qalbi, that is tafakkur, which is contemplation, reflection. Allah talks about this. He says, وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. They think and reflect about the creation of the heavens and the earth. رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا. These are the people. يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا عَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ. And whenever Allah mentions that, He says after that, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ. Most of these verses are ended with, indeed in this there are signs. For who? Not that list I gave you. لِقَوْمِ يَعْقِلُونَ. The people of Aql. لِقَوْمِ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. The people who think and reflect. لِقَوْمِ يَعْقِلُونَ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. لَآيَاتٍ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. The people of real intelligence. All these verses when Allah says sign, 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 for people of real intelligence. And this is something we need to do. We need to think. You know, life is so fast. We wake up, or we die, or we don't die. We do die at night, because that's also death. Sleep is the sister of death. The Quran says, "Allah yatawaffa al-anfus hina mawtiha, wallati lam tamut fi manamiha." The ones who don't die, like proper death, Allah takes away the soul when you sleep. That's why when you wake up in the morning, what do we say? We should be saying, "Alhamdulillah alladhi ahyana." Praise to Allah who gave us life. بَعْدَمَا أَمَاتَنَا. After he gave us death, we were dead at night. We woke up in the morning, new lease of life. So, all of these things, thinking, life is too fast. This is one of the things that leads us to atheism, because our children, we're too engrossed. As parents, sometimes we don't think about anything except their degree, their studies, their worldly prosperity. What about deen and iman? Who cares? And then when they leave Islam, then we start crying, no, my son's left Islam. Now suddenly I want a miraculous button, I press the green button and suddenly becomes a Muslim. It's not going to work like that, sorry to be frank. It starts from a young age. You had to put that seed of Iman when he was two. Not just two, when he was born, you did do that. You said Adhan in his ear. And you said Iqama in his ear. That was a Sunnah. Alhamdulillah, we're starting with that. But some of us, we just do that and then we stop. And then we think about Iman again when they're 25, when they've left in Iman. What happened in the 25 years? Of course they will leave Islam, because we're just worried about their worldly prosperity, not their religious prosperity. It's a responsibility. It's a sad fact. It's true. And this is why. Why did we say the adhan in the ear? There's a hikmah. Does anybody remember this? We don't remember it. Yet, the hikmah behind this is that as soon as the child is born, we're instilling into the heart and the mind of the child Iman billah, wal iman bil rasul, bil rasul, or bil rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, bil shahada. Iman is being instilled. Even though you don't remember, but it has an impact. Just like before you were born, every single one of us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took an oath. وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمْ يُوَلُّوا أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. Am I not your Lord? قَالُوا بَلَا شَهِدْنَا. We all said yes. Every single one, we agree. Do you remember? Does anybody remember here? Anyone remember? Some of the early Salaf, they said we actually remember. But if we don't remember, it doesn't mean we deny it. Does anybody remember being pregnant? Being in the mother's, in their mother's stomach or womb? Yeah, brother, anybody here? Do you remember one day you were your mom was 7 months pregnant, and remember you were in the stomach and it was a bit bumpy, she was going down the stairs and you were going like that as well. Does anybody remember? No. Does anybody deny that they were in their mother's stomach? Of course not. Doesn't mean if you don't remember something, you deny it. This happened, it's in the Quran, we all agreed. So, the Quran talks about tafakkur. Okay, I know time is another 10 to 15 minutes, maximum inshallah 10, 30, no more, because I know everyone gets tired and you need to go. I don't like to carry on talking and then you don't know when I'm going to stop. So then you're thinking, should I go or should I not go? I don't know how long this guy. Because it's important, you know, to harm people emotionally, psychologically, like that is also not in accordance with the teachings of Islam. And I know how it feels. When will this speaker, I really need to go, but like it looks bad, I'm going to stand up and walk all the way there. So I'll just tell you, maximum 10, 30 inshallah. I won't go over that. So, what was I saying?
10:30.
Before that. I was saying about tafakkur. So that's a very good solution. Because it's only 15 minutes. I really want to talk about it now, practical things. Do that with your family. And think about the ni'mah of Allah. Every ni'mah. You know, I just mentioned this. The Quran talks about even a cup of milk. When a milk comes to you, how did it get to us? مِنْ بَيْنِ فَرْثٍ وَدَمٍ لَبَنًا خَالِصًا سَائِغًا لِشَارِبِينَ. The Quran says when you get a cup of milk, don't just drink it like that. Use your understanding, your brain, your reasoning. Look at this milk. This came from a cow. It came from a process right in between blood and filth. This was red blood. This was filth, smelly. Yet when it comes into your glass, it is خَالِص. It is pure. سَائِغًا لِشَارِبِينَ. No foul smell, nothing. Who made this? Everything Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all these things, there's so much you can think about. But we need the aql, we need the real understanding. You can be in a flight, you can look at everything around you. It's just It's just so amazing, the whole cosmos system. So this is tafakkur. Then I was saying that doubts come into the minds. Doubts do come, like, is there really a creator? Did Allah really create this or this and that, and all the different doubts that comes. If somebody is a mu'min, a believer, and these doubts come, nothing to worry about it. These are natural, these are normal, these happen. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually talked about these doubts. These are called waswasa, misgivings from the shaitan. Once a companion came and complained, this happened to a companion, he came and complained to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam about doubts in the mind. He said, ذَاكَ صَرِيحُ الْإِيمَانِ. That's actually clear iman. وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ ذَاكَ مَحْضُ الْإِيمَانِ. This is a sign of pure iman. This is iman, don't worry about these doubts. And the scholars give an example that this is shaitan and iblis, and Satan only comes to, like a thief will only come to a house or a property where he thinks he can get something. If it's a rundown property, he knows he's not going to get nothing in there, then he won't bother. He will only come to a believer who starts practicing. That's why when you start practicing, more waswasa will come in your mind. One brother came to me and said, when I don't practice, so like nothing comes in my mind. When I'm practicing, now all these doubts are coming. I said, that's what's going to happen. Because if you're not praying, then you're not thinking about deen, you're not thinking about salah, you're not thinking, now you're praying, you're fasting. You know, a lot of times all our thoughts come when we do Allahu Akbar. Bad thoughts come when? You know, with those thoughts, sometimes even like bad thoughts, they never come outside. In salah, they come, especially they come in salah. That's shaitan, that's a clear sign that shaitan has come specially to distract you in your prayer. And this is what we need to fight against. It's a test. So don't be too worried about it. And that's one of the remedies for this as well, is from the sunnah, is to recite as much as possible surah. Which surah? An-Nas. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ. We say Allah's name 3 times. I seek protection and refuge of رَبُّ النَّاسِ, the Lord of the people. مَلِكِ النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ. And then after that, we say, مِنْ شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ. Oh Allah, I seek your protection, refuge from who? مِنْ شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ. Waswas is from the word waswasa, the one who places all these doubts and misgivings in your heart, in your mind. And the Quran said, not just waswas, al-khannas. Khannas is a plural, or not a plural, sorry. It's a sighatul mubalagha, a word of exaggeration for the word khanis. Khanis means somebody who gives you the waswasa and then goes and hides, retreats like a mouse. Have you seen a mouse? Hold. Click back in. The word khanis is like someone who comes, does something quickly, goes back. Then comes back again, peeps again, does a small thing, quickly nibbles on the cheese, back. Then comes back. That's the meaning of khanis. Shaitan is extremely khanis, khannas, exaggerated version of khanis. That's his job. What does he do? He gives the waswasa and then he retreats. And then, he comes back. He retreats a lot. How does he retreat? He retreats because he's very scared. Just like the mouse is very, very scared. The mouse is very weak. Shaitan is very weak. The Quran says, "Inna kayda shaytani kana da'ifa." The shaitan's claw is very, very weak. Just like the mouse is very weak. You know, you just a bit of sound and the mouse is gone. It's very difficult. The shaitan is like that. A bit of dua, a bit of attention to a shaitan, like, just look at him and that's it, it's gone. One dua, and this is what Allah wants from us. That if shaitan is trying to put waswasa from you, into you, the Quran says, وَإِمَّا يَنْزَغَنَّكَ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ نَزْغٌ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ. Seek protection from Allah, refuge, dua, just a slight bit of attention to it, and turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then shaitan's waswasa will go away. So, as long as we turn to Allah with sincerity, with cleanliness of heart and mind, then inshaAllah ta'ala we will see that these doubts will be erased. So, and then just a couple of more points that after these doubts, and I talked about some of these things. Now, just 2 or 3 more brief points. Some of the times why a lot of people, they become like they start doubting is because of, I mean, sadly we have to say, because of the actions of the Muslims themselves. And there's 2 types of things I really, really feel sad about even mentioning them, especially the second thing, but it's a reality. The first one is when a lot of Muslims, they confuse culture and Islam. I know so many young people, I've dealt with so many young people, not just in England, but elsewhere as well, where they get frustrated because of the family, the parents, people around them, and who force onto them a version of Islam which is not really Islam, it's just cultural, whichever culture you're from the Arab world or from Pakistan or from Bangladesh or from India or from whatever. There's a difference between Islamic teachings and cultural teachings. A lot of the issues are to do with marriage. A lot of the issues are to do with, like for example, forced marriage. There is no place in Islam, categorically, totally, wholeheartedly, whatever word you want to use, it is completely unlawful in Islam for parents to apply any sort of force on the children in marriage. They have a basic right to marry who they want to marry. There's clear hadith, Sahih al-Bukhari, pick them up. There's clear hadith. Sahih Muslim, clear hadith. There's every book of fiqh will say, La ijbar, la tujbar, la tujbar. There is no force. Arranged marriages like helping, that's fine. But there is no force. It's got nothing to do with Islam. Because of this, some children become frustrated. They rebel. When they rebel, they think the way to rebel is go against religion as well. Because that's the way to rebel. First of all, think that, look, you're not believing because of your parents anyway. So you shouldn't, it's not like, okay, you're tough, I'm going to like show you now, I'm going to leave Islam as well. You shouldn't be like that. But this is what happens. So we need to ensure that sometimes, you know, due to this, sometimes like a bad experience. Bad experience in the name of religion. This happened with Christianity as well. You know, some of them in the church or with the clergy, they had some bad experiences and they just rebelled and then they left Islam altogether. So some people, they have this bad experience because of them, in the name of religion, of the people who are in religion, who portrayed gave a bad image of religion. And this is one of the major factors contributing towards some people leaving Islam altogether. I have many examples of that. And another thing which is even more worse than that, is that, sadly speaking, this is really sad, it's difficult to even talk about, is the, how can I put this in the nicest way, is the very, like, let me use some words which I could measure. This is really, and recently I've seen this a lot of young people have told me about this. So one of the things that creates doubt and they just think, what is all this Islam about? Is basically the inner fighting of the Muslims, of different groups and different denominations. Go onto YouTube today, any YouTube channel, it's all about refutations, it's all about polemics, it's all about this argument, that argument, he's a kafir, she's a kafir, he's a mushrik, that's a mushrik. No two Muslims can agree on anything. You don't have to agree as well. I'm not saying everybody changed their views, Islam, that's another topic, you can have difference of opinion. But there's Islam tells us to talk in a calm manner with a non-Muslim, with a disbeliever in Allah, even with your enemy, like one of the subconscious scholars used to say that, look, whoever you're talking to is not going to be worse than Pharaoh, and you're not better than Musa. Yet Allah said to Musa to speak to Pharaoh, قُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا, speak to him gently. Musa and Harun, Allah said, when you go to Fir'aun, speak to him gently. Whoever you're talking to today, even if he's like a Shia or a Qadiani, whatever he is he worse than Pharaoh? No. And you're not better than Musa. Yet Allah is telling him to speak to him gently. Go on YouTube and the absolute opposite of gentleness. Absolute. And some things are crazy. There's like some, sadly speaking, some are so-called scholars. In the Arab world right now, there's a discussion, they did a survey online. They asked some atheists that what made you become, they gave, like, you know, on Twitter you have, you know, percentage. What's the reason that you became atheist? 57% was Shuyukh al-Islam fighting. In the Arab world. Some of these sheikhs are fighting, that made us leave Islam. One person, I heard this from a scholar, in England, some sister, she became Muslim. When she became Muslim, by a group of people, then next day somebody came, so did these guys make you Muslim? They're not following real Islam. Forget them. They took all the books away, they bought all their versions of the books. This is true Islam, read this. She said, okay, maybe, you know, I'm going to the wrong hands. But anyway, alhamdulillah, next day somebody else came. What books are these? Like, who told you? These are things. They gave their books. Next day, or after a few days, somebody else came. Who told you to get into those hands? They're not proper Muslims. They're mushriks. These are the real Tawheed Islam. This is the one. Take all the books. That sister said, you know what, if it's this first 4 days, you might as well just do away with it altogether, and she left Islam. Don't know if you should cry on this or smile on this. So this is a big, big problem. Everywhere, you know, the discussions that used to take place in an academic fashion in classrooms are now taking place on Facebook and internet and YouTube. And that's the problem. All these debates, they were academic debates. You know, some of them are academic discussions, scholarly discussions. Muslims, they did do that. But it was in a classroom setting, not on YouTube. And the way people are shouting and fighting, and you know, if you go to YouTube in Pakistan, for example, sometimes, it's like putting a book and, yeah, takbir, and we've won, and you've lost, and you're crazy, and your dad this, and your mom this, and in the name of Islam. Seriously, they swear at one another sometimes. It's like basic human manners are gone. Basic. You know, you wouldn't even talk to your worst enemy like the way some people talk when they debate about religious matters. Everyone's calling everyone a kafir, everyone's calling everyone a mushrik. Everyone's calling everyone like, you know, you've left and we're the best. And I'm not saying, you know, that everybody should accept everybody's views. Nobody's saying that. But there's a way of discussing, there's a way of dealing with people. There's a way of debating. Udu'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah wal maw'izatil hasana. Invite towards your Lord with hikmah, with good preaching. Wajadilhum billati hiya ahsan. The Quran says, even with the Christians and Jews, we need to discuss. Discuss billati hiya ahsan, in a pleasant way, talk to them. Don't even fight and argue with Christians and Jews. So this is one of the main reasons why this happens. And lastly, and this is a topic on its own, one of the last reasons why a lot of people sometimes start questioning is specific issues where they have, why does Islam give the right of, for example, inheritance two to a man and one to a woman? Why is the divorce in the right of the man or not directly? Women do have a right to divorce, but in a different way. You know, specific issues, like why did the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam marry Aisha radiallahu anha when she was 9 years old, etc., etc. All these kind of questions come, and that can happen with any religion. That could happen with atheism as well. It could happen with everything. And the type of situation we're living in, we question everything. Fine, we can question everything. We study at the university, and everything is questioned. No problem, you can question it. But then go with an open, clean-hearted, open and clean mind, unbiased mind. Every single issue, there is a very clear, clean, pure explanation. Things which are established. Some things might just be cultural. There might not be anything to do with Islam. So then, don't get confused between those issues which are cultural and which are real Islam. And if there are real things of Islam, and then you have doubts, then go to people of knowledge, go to people of wisdom, people of hikmah, people who have deep knowledge. Not everybody is really portraying to be a knowledgeable person is knowledgeable. Not everybody is knowledgeable. You know, we live in a time, we sadly, and I'm not a scholar as well, but we live in a time that we don't even recognize who the scholars are. That's one, for me, one of the crises of the time is we don't know who really a scholar is. That's why they used to say in Arabic, إِنَّمَا يَعْرِفُ الْفَضْلَ لِأَهْلِ الْفَضْلِ ذَوُ الْفَضْلِ. The people of virtue is only the virtue of the people of virtue is only recognized by those of virtue. إِنَّمَا يَعْرِفُ الْفَضْلَ لِأَهْلِ الْفَضْلِ ذَوُ الْفَضْلِ. In order for you to, you know, discover or recognize someone of virtue, you have to have some virtue yourself. So we're living in this time because there's a crisis, ignorance about deen. So when that's the case, we don't really know who really a scholar is. I'm not saying anything bad about any other person. Everyone's, alhamdulillah, doing different things. But some people are like, for example, da'is. Not every da'i is a scholar. Not every speaker is a scholar. I'm speaking right now, that doesn't mean I'm a scholar. I could be a good speaker, which I'm doing good. Speaking is also a very good, positive thing. Nothing wrong with it. But you have to go to the right people. People have different fields. Real scholars are few. And they have deep knowledge of the Quran. And you go and get all these issues clarified by them. And then inshallah, if you go with an open heart and mind, you will see that a lot of these things will be sorted out. As I said, I just made this talk in a very non-academic way, like just based it all mostly on fitrah. Based it all on this is the, you know, the basic dalil of the existence of Allah is the dalil of fitrah, the natural disposition, the natural inclination of the human being. It's naturally born in the heart and mind for a human being to believe in a God. Maybe not your God, but some super being. You know, even the atheists, they natural forces. What's your natural forces? You know, Mother Nature. What's Mother Nature? Just say Father Nature then, or God Nature. it's natural. Something's there, some being, something, UFO or something. Maybe UFO is your God or something. But this is this natural thing in every human being. And that's what I've been based this on. As for an academic talk, there's lots of issues. We can talk about, you know, how the atheists, there's different types. Some believe in the Big Bang Theory, the existence of, you know, this world that it came from nothing, it came into existence by itself, and all these other different things that can be discussed on some other occasion, or maybe you can read books on this, or maybe listen to some other people, or maybe really sit down. You can't really discuss these issues in just 1 hour lecture. You need a whole series of classes and courses on these topics. I taught Aqidah, for many years I've been teaching, and we discussed this over about 7 weeks, all the different, you know, objections of the atheists and how intellectually, sorry I've gone 2 minutes over time, how intellectually we can prove using the same arguments of the atheist, modern day arguments, it is completely logical to prove the existence of a creator. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our iman and our progeny and our children. And make us steadfast on thee. Life is very short. We're here for 10, 20, 30, 40 years. 60, 70 is the average lifespan. And we all have to go. So we go with iman, inshallah. That's the most important thing, inshallah. May Allah keep us on iman. You know, this is the greatest fear, that we leave without iman or our children. If we have iman, then inshallah, nobody's perfect. Everybody's sinful. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam relates in a hadith from Allah, he says, رَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ غَضَبِي. Allah's main attribute is rahmah. By default, Allah is ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. He also punishes, but by default, He's Rahman ar-Rahim, unless otherwise. But by default, that's why Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, not al-Muntaqim, Shadid al-Iqab. So, therefore, if someone shows some sign of turning to Allah, some sign, then inshallah Allah's mercy is there to forgive and give a good hereafter. We just need to turn slightly. Because everyone sins. You might say, well, this is a practicing person. When you say practicing person, does that mean that he has no, only prophets who are infallible? Everyone commits a sin. If you say, oh, how can't be like this pious person? But that pious person, doesn't mean he's also committed sins. He may have committed less sin than me as a sinful one, but he's committed 4. If Allah can forgive his 4, why can't he forgive my 10? If Allah can forgive his, everyone's got a sin. If you're thinking the pious people, they're so pious, but even the pious people have sins. So if Allah can forgive the pious people, they might have less sins, why can't he forgive my sins? The only difference is that sometimes the problem is when there's a heart becomes like blind. When there's nothing, we don't even think, we don't even want to turn to Allah. You know, this is what we call khata, like a seed. That's a dangerous situation to be in. May Allah protect us from being in that situation.